Good morning once again, and welcome to New Beginnings House of Worship for our morning worship service. We know that God will bless you richly this day for your assistance and your continued support of this man. This time, we're going to ask Sister Rosalind Turnipseed to come along and give you our morning welcome.
Good morning. Welcome to New Beginnings House of Worship. We feel so blessed to share this time with you. God has truly been good and has kept us regardless of our shortcomings. Give him a thankful praise and have a good week. We want to give out some shout outs to our birthday family members this week. Tomorrow we'll be celebrating my sister Judy's birthday on October 11th. On October 12th, we'll be celebrating our granddaughter Kiara Turnipseed's birthday. She will be entering her teenage years. She'll be turning 13, so a big happy birthday to Kiara. On October 13th, we'll be celebrating our little Billy Bob, we call him, Deacon Billy, Butler. He'll be celebrating his birthday up in the mountains. We say happy birthday to you, Billy. And then a big happy birthday to our daughter, Rachelle. She rounds out the week. Her birthday will be October 14th, and we're wishing her a very blessed and happy birthday. Have a good week, and everybody out there in October land, have a happy birthday. Thank you. God bless.
Amen. Thank you for those birthday shout-outs and our morning welcome. We know that you feel welcome now and that you want to be a part of this worship experience. We want to also just thank God for the lives of those who are celebrating their birthdays and anniversaries this month. And we know that on Monday, it's typically in Columbus Day, that Columbus Day celebration goes on, but it's also considered Indigenous Peoples Day. And so we want to recognize our Native Americans and all of those Indigenous peoples across the land and the country and on this globe that are Indigenous to their lands that are going through situations. And just as I mentioned, we wanted to, in celebration of Indigenous Peoples Week, we're going to post some of the movies that were recommended on a particular site that you may want to use to as a something to watch, and then use it as a teaching tool to talk about Indigenous people of this land, Native Americans. We have some facts here that there are about 710 missing and murdered Indigenous women over the past decade in the state of Wyoming alone. 710. And we know that there was a lot going on and mentioned about Gabby Petito's murder, disappearance and murder, and our heartfelt condolences to the family. But that brought a lot of attention to the fact that all of the media resources that went into trying to find and locate Gabby Petito, when you have so in the state of Wyoming, and you had so many Indigenous people that were coming up missing. So we give a shout out and prayers and blessings to all the families of all missing black and brown women across this nation and our Indigenous sisters across this land and country as well. All right, so this morning we want to give you call your attention to the book of Matthew chapter 15. Matthew chapter 15, and we're going to lift up verses 21 through 28 for our message this morning. Matthew chapter 15, verses 21 through 28 for our message this morning. And we want you to keep your Bibles open and whatever version of the Bible you use. I typically read from the King James Version, which I will be today. But just follow along with us. The Word of God will speak truth. Amen. And so our message today, coming from Matthew 15, verse 21 through 28, says, "Then Jesus went thence and departed into the coast of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, a woman of Canaan came out of the same coast and cried unto him, saying, Have mercy on me, O Lord, thou son of David. My daughter is grievously vexed with the devil. But he answered her not a word. And his disciples came and besought him, saying, Send her away, for she cries after us. But he answered and said, I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Then came she and worshipped him, saying, Lord, help me. But he answered and said, it is not meet to take the children's bread and to cast it to dogs. And she said, truth, Lord, yet the dogs eat of the crumbs which fall from their masters' table. Then Jesus answered and said unto her, O woman, great is thy faith. Be it unto thee even as thou wilt. And her daughter was made whole from that very hour. Amen. Thus ends the reading of God's word. And so for today, we just like to use for a thought, don't live life in the margins. Don't live, in the margins of life. Don't live in the margins of life. The biblical truth we want to leave with you today, as we typically like to give a biblical truth, is that if you truly believe that the Lord is a very present help, nothing will keep you from him. Nothing will keep you from him. And so as you think about this message today, we want you to keep that thought in mind, that if you truly believe in him, trust in him, and know that he is your Lord and your Savior, nothing should ever keep you from him. And so when we think about living a marginalized life, and there are a lot of things that go on in society today that people are marginalized, and people try to marginalize groups and sets of people based on all sort of things, their sex, their national origin, where they live. And so we have to not allow people to make us live a life that is marginalized. And so when we think about being marginalized, it means to treat a person, a group, or a concept as insignificant or peripheral, something on the outside. You don't belong on the inside with us. Everything goes on right in the middle. Everything on the outside, you're just coincidental. It also means to put or keep in a powerless or unimportant position within a society or group. To keep or place in a powerless or unimportant position within a society or a group. And we do that a lot in our society, in this nation, in the capitalistic environment that we live in. And when we think about all the issues going on in this country now, and we think about the women that we just mentioned, indigenous women that have gone missing, and missing and murdered, and nothing, hardly anything being said about it. We know that a group of people are being marginalized. We think about the indigenous people of this land and how they lived in tribes and nations all across these Americas, this America that we live in. And they are now minimalized into reservations in the small portions of the land that they once roamed freely in. And so how is that going on? How do we treat people? And we call them savages. We call them rapists and murderers that come out of certain countries, that they're just a bunch of rapists and murderers. And we hear this rhetoric in our political scenes from our politicians. And we start hearing all of these things about how we easily can put somebody in a group and make them powerless and make them unimportant and really make them, or to just vilify them so that no one will want to even have any dealings with them. We marginalize people so much in this country. When we think about the plight of the poor, the undereducated, the unemployed, and the undernourished people of this country, we don't have to go to a third world country to find these things. Where all of these things are happening and people are just being marginalized because we don't spend the resources in certain communities to make sure that they receive the education that they should be given, that everyone else is given. We don't employ people that live in these areas. We say that they don't have any skill set. They don't have the knowledge level. Well, if we undereducate them, then will they ever get that? And so we keep people in a cycle that they are not able to advance in this society. And so when they are undernourished and undereducated and underemployed, how do you expect people to get out of those situations? And so we have to think about some of the things that, that go on in this society. Excuse me. And so when we look at political parties and how they are, these factions set up, and the two-party system was supposedly to keep it to where no one group of people would have a dominance over the political scene. But now it's just become such a vicious cycle, and both parties have faults and failures within them. And we notice even in these election cycles how the Republican budget cuts that could come in, and when they come about, the majority of the cuts affect programs for low-income people. They affect Medicaid. They affect the Affordable Care Act, food stamps, Pell Grants, Supplemental Security Income, your Social Security to the elderly, the Earned Income Tax Credit, and more and more. And so here we pay taxes into this government to provide for us, and the politicians are saying, no, we can't spend all of this money on the people. We'll spend it on rich companies. We'll give them tax credits and tax breaks. And so we are marginalizing people. We're marginalizing the elderly. We're marginalizing the poor. We're marginalizing people by their ethnicity and their heritage. And so we have to stop doing these things in order to give people a shot at life for hope, shot at life for advancement and success. And we know that only comes through Jesus Christ. And so we have to make sure that we as the church are making people aware that they are more than their condition, more than the situation that they face in life. So I need somebody out there to just touch yourself and say, don't live your life in the margins. Don't live your life in the margins. Don't allow what other people say about you and how they group or classify you to make you think that you have to live that lifestyle because someone else has placed you into that. And so as I was mentioning earlier, when we are in the type of society that we're in, which is based on capitalism, a capitalistic society out of necessity pushes a segment of its people into the margins and tells them what is the best thing for them. This is best for you. Then they'll provide you with those things that are only gonna profit them in the end. So they'll put you in a community and tell you that this type of housing is the type of housing that you need, and we will only put a little bitty market in that area, and that's where you have some place to get you something to eat that may not even provide a good nutritious meal. But then you look at other communities that are popping up everywhere, and they have three or four well-stocked markets and grocery stores. And so we tend to just push people into the margins of life because we are so capitalistic and everybody wants to make a profit off of everything, that no one's reaching out to help anyone. We become rich young rulers wanting to hang on to everything we have, but not willing to give anything away for the advancement of God's kingdom. Do we find ourselves in those situations? And so we did a thing several years ago with the youth of our church. We were at Tabernacle Baptist Church, and we would get them and put them in the church van and ride around through the city and take a look at the grocery stores and the little markets and shops. In certain neighborhoods, we'll go into the black neighborhood, and you'll look at them, and they'll go inside the stores and see what's being offered. What's in the windows? What do you see in the windows of the markets? And you'll always find cigarettes and beer and advertisement in the windows of the smaller markets. And then when you go in and see, you'll see the types of beers and the type of things, the food, the meat that are offered. And then you go into neighborhoods that are well-kept and well-stocked, and whether it's a large grocery store or just a small market. And yes, you might see some beers advertised, but then you see a large array of of fine beers and German beers and dark beers and all of these different, as opposed to just the malt liquors in our neighborhoods. And then you look at the meats and you see the offerings of the meat. You might see more steaks and seafood. And then you go into the black neighborhood and you'll just see a certain type of meat. I'm not going to even start naming all that to further vilify the types of meats that we eat. But the point is this, is that we will not give anything more in areas that are in need than this society think that they deserve. And so we marginalize people. We make them feel that this is the only thing that you are worthy of. These are the only things that you should have. And we have to stop marginalizing people in our society. Look at your neighbor and say, don't live life in the margins. And so when we look at these situations, and even in our communities, no regular preventive police protection. We don't have the police that will come into the neighborhoods. And now I do know that in Nashville, now they are trying to do more, and in other major cities since George Floyd, that they're trying to change some of the policing. But it's and we celebrate what they're able to do, they're trying to do now. But there's so much more that needs to be done. And so, yes, it takes a little patience and to work through it, but we can't let the foot off the gas and just let things trickle down. There are some changes that need to come and need to be made immediately. And so that our communities feel safe, that our kids feel safe to go out and play. It's a crying shame that kids going out to play or even just playing in their home become the victims of so much gun violence. And we're living in a state where guns, anybody can carry a gun any place. You don't even need a permit anymore. If I'm going to have a dog and take him for a walk, I need a permit to have that dog. He needs to be licensed. I need to get him a tag. I need to get his shots to show that he's had his shots. He or she has had its shots. I can't drive a car without having a license. But now we're saying that people can walk, go around and don't need a carry permit. The carry permit is not just a license to say that you can have a gun, but it came with certain things that you had to be trained, just like you have to with the car. You can't just get in a car and say, I have a license just because I bought a car. No, you have to pass a test that shows that you can drive that vehicle safely and understand the signs on the road. And so the same thing with guns. It's not about keeping someone from having a gun. It's about making sure that people are trained and know how to use a gun. And so now guns are being stolen from vehicles left and right, and there are no penalties for that. But you do anything else, you leave a dog in a car, and somebody come along and see that, and in a hot car, then you can be brought up on charges, as well as you should be. If you're leaving anything that's living in a hot car that's locked up, whether it's a dog, an animal, a child, or anything else. But the point is this, that we emphasize the things that we want to penalize certain people, but allow others to go unchecked. And so we marginalize people so much in this society. What does that have to do with this text? Well, I'm glad you asked. Let's look into this text today. Look into verse 22. We find out some things here about this woman. We find out some things about her heritage. We find out about where she lives. We find out her spiritual IQ. Very important in this text. And we find out about her heart's desires, her wants, her needs, her main concern in verse 22. Look what it says. It says, and behold, a woman of Canaan came out of the same coast and cried unto him, saying, have mercy on me, O Lord, thou son of David. My daughter is grievously vexed with the devil. The woman in this text is the one who is being marginalized. Her and her daughter, actually. But she is really the main focus. And when she's marginalized, it affects the life and the well-being of her daughter as well. The woman is being marginalized by the writer of this text. The woman is being marginalized by the disciples. And it would even appear as though she's being marginalized even by Jesus, by his response, and by first of all, his lack of response, and then the response that he gave after that. And so when we look into this text and see that sometimes situations come up where you are in dire need, and no matter what that situation is in your life, and you're trying to make things right for the situation, you have an expressed need, an expressed concern. We need to carry it to Jesus every time. The woman with the issue of blood, she was marginalized. And so in her case, it's a little bit differently because it was a medical situation. And we think about the pandemic now that's going on, and people don't want to take the precautions. They don't want to go into quarantine when it's necessary to protect the public. And so the woman with the issue of blood, she came out of quarantine and went in amongst the people. But she went seeking after Jesus, the only source of help that was available to her. So what are you saying, preacher? No, I'm not saying that just because you want to go to church and you want to go to church and pray and then expose everybody else to your situation, because we can call on Jesus anywhere. And so this woman, she comes to Jesus with her issue and her concern about her daughter. Notice what the text says. And behold, a woman of Canaan. She was a Canaanite. So she was one of the people that they didn't want to have anything with. They were supposed to have been expelled from the land long time ago. They were supposed to have been done away with. And so the Canaanites were always one of the countries that was a thorn in the flesh of the Israelites. So they came into the land and took hold of the land. And so not only that, but she's described as a woman. Now, you can say that maybe they're trying to marginalize her. But that's just describing her gender, who she is. She is a woman. But in this society today, we marginalize women, and we don't give any, we don't provide the same services. We don't make things available as much for women as we do for men. Men can run things and do all of these things, have positions, make more money in the same jobs than women. And we still find that going on today. And even as we talk about our indigenous sisters and the missing and murdered indigenous women across this nation, we see that they have been marginalized for so long. And so when we look at this, it says she's a woman of Canaan. It deals with her heritage. It also describes where she's from in verse 21, when it says, when Jesus went thence and departed into the coast of Tyre and Sidon. So when it says that she was a woman of Canaan in verse 22, out of the same coast, meaning that she was from Tyre and Sidon. And then that region, the people there, they've had booms, and they were where they were doing a lot of things, and they were a productive coastal city, but they were also one of the cities that were proclaimed to just be so wicked and vile and against the Israelites, and were always coming up against them and causing problems. There were times when they were mentioned in a good light. Jesus went there and he healed many people in Tyre and Sidon. He would visit there often. But he also said that it would be more, it would be much easier for the people of Tyre and Sidon to enter in than the Chorazin, those people that of the Jewish faith and belief, because of the way that they behaved themselves. So it didn't paint a perfect picture of Tyre and Sidon, but it's saying how bad and how depraved the minds of some of the Jewish people were. And so she was a Canaanite. She was from the region of Tyre and Sidon, which everybody knew of the problems and the issues that they've had historically. And so when we look at this woman, but we see some things about this woman, how she came to Jesus. Notice what she said. When she came to him, she cried out to him saying, "Have mercy on me, O Lord, thou son of David." And when she describes him as her Lord, and that's a very important thing that identifies her spiritual IQ, how versed she was on who this man Jesus was. She called him Lord. And when we call someone Lord, that means that he's their master, someone who has control over that you submit and surrender to. The Lord is the master of something or someone and having absolute authority over it or them. Absolute authority. She placed herself at his feet and says, "I surrender to you." And so do we do that as Christians? Have we really surrendered ourselves to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ? or are we escalating ourselves and elevating ourselves based on our own personal goals and our personal successes in life? And so this woman, but then she also calls him Son of David. This is Jesus's messianic title, the Son of David. It means that he is the long-awaited deliverer that everyone has been waiting for, the fulfillment of the Old Testament prophecies, that Jesus is the Son of David. And not only that, but that also gives him, paints him in the picture of the one who would return to the throne. And so she's putting herself at the hand of the mercy of her Lord, the one that she surrenders to and knows that he has all authority, and she surrenders herself and her authority to him, that he would grant her her wish and her need. Tell somebody. She's trying to get out of the margins. Tell yourself, how do you try, how diligent do you try to get out of the margins of life that someone else has painted you into? And we have to move forward in the Lord to do that. She tells Jesus her heart's desire. She needs her daughter healed because she is vexed with the devil. And we can sit there and talk about mental illness, and we sometimes always want to paint that picture of people that are vexed with the devil. This is beyond that. There are some similarities maybe, but she has an evil spirit. This is not just a mental disorder. This is a spiritual disorder that she is being controlled and manipulated by a demon. And so here this woman is crying out for her heart's desire. So what do you do when you pray and you pray and you pray and you can't hear anything from Jesus? Look at the text. It says that she cried out and said, "My daughter is grievously vexed with the devil." Look at verse 23. It says, "But he answered her not a word." What do you do when you pray and you pray for a situation to change in your life and you don't hear a word from the Lord? Well, scripture tells us to wait. Wait, I say, on the Lord. You don't know what God is doing in the background. We don't see what's going on. We don't understand the situation. We are experiencing something that is grievous to us, and we don't understand what's going on. And we need to wait on the Lord. This ministry was born out of waiting. New Beginnings, House of Worship, and I can recall back in around 2003 and even earlier than that, I had pastored and ended my pastoring in 2001 and went back to my home church, Tabernacle Baptist Church, and thoughts came to me about some situations, and people came to me with things, and we just talked in our last moment in the Word on Saturday about counsel. We need many counselors, multiple counselors to get us through. We need to hear and seek good advice from good counselors, not just one, but many, a multitude of counselors. And so I had several people come to me and talk to me. They were trying to push me one way or the other about the benefits of starting your own church and doing things. And those things kind of came on my mind. But the thing for me was, until I hear God specifically say it, I was not going to go that route. This is not about me trying to establish a church so I could have a place to preach. And so in March of this year, March 8th, the Lord spoke to me and clearly allowed me and informed me to start a church that was online so that people can make sure that they still get the Word of God, and not just in one place, but it can go out amongst God's people across this country. And so we started New Beginnings House of Worship. But that was 2021, and from 2013, that's 18 years. And so we have to wait on the Lord. If we try to get ahead of God, we'll mess things up. Yes, people might be telling you this, that, or the other, but you can seek wise counsel, but wait on the Lord. Don't allow yourself to be marginalized. Don't allow yourself to be pushed into corners, but wait on the Lord to make the move that you really need to make, and he will guide you. That doesn't mean we sit still and just wait and wait and sit and not do anything. God is still working on us. So God worked on me with this ministry and things that I needed to do. And so we find ourselves in situations where we have to wait, I say, on the Lord. And we know that time is going by swiftly. So we're going to move quickly throughout this text. There are many things that we had to say this morning. But listen to once that she went to the Lord and she sought him diligently to have her needs met. Look what is going on. And this is sometimes what happens in our life, that we have to be able to see what God is doing. And when we respond the wrong way, what God is really trying to teach us and those that are there who are supposed to be helping people, how we need to respond. Look at the disciples. Look how they chimed into this situation. When everything went silent, the disciples decided to speak up when Jesus didn't say anything. So they thought this was their chance to step up and get this thing cleared up. It said in verse 23, but he answered her not a word. And his disciples came and besought him, saying, send her away, for she cries after us. And that phrase, send her away, is an interesting phrase that we were able to look up and see what was going on. It means to loose from. Jesus gives her what they're telling Jesus, please just give her what she need so she can leave us alone. Give her something just so that she can leave us alone and so that we can go on about doing the things that we need to do. Loose her from this need. Fulfill it for her so she can be loosed from us. that's the context of that phrase, send her away. So that let's loose her from this situation so that she won't have this constant begging from us. And that's what we're talking about earlier about society and how to marginalize people. We'll give them a little something and it won't be really what they need. We just give them something that we think that they need. And we'll give them a little something and give them a little of this, put a little something in the neighborhood and say, that's okay. We'll give a little attention to crime in your area. We'll send a police car every 2 years to circle the blocks and then go on out so that we can say that we did something to help with safety and security in your neighborhood. And so the society will sometimes do some things and give you just enough to say that we did something just to push you on out of the way. And that's what the disciples are doing. But notice that Jesus then speaks to the woman's situation. That the disciples are just crying and saying, Lord, get rid of her, send her away, because this woman is constantly crying out and begging from us and nagging us one thing after the way. Please just send her away. You need to know when people are marginalizing you, because the help they want to give you isn't ever going to be quite enough. It's never meant to benefit you. Somebody say, stay out of the margins. Stay out of the margins. Look at what Jesus does when he speaks to the woman in verse 24. It says, but he answered and said, and here's the disciples. He's now speaking to the disciples because they wanted Jesus to send her away. Do something. Do something for her. Give her something so that she'll leave us. He says, but the text says, but he answered and said, I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. That's my mission. Why do you want me to give her something and send her away? I'm here for the lost sheep of Israel. And so the disciples get perplexed here. But notice they don't respond. But notice who responds in verse 25. After Jesus tell what his mission is. His mission isn't here concerned with the needs of the Canaanite woman. That's not what he's here for. Verse 25 says, then came she and worshiped him, saying, Lord, help me. She came not only the first time when she came and called him Lord and placed herself under his authority and recognized him as the soon-to-be crowned king, the son of David, but now she comes and worships him and cries out to him even more. And so that's what we need to do when the society and everything else try to marginalize us. Continue being persistent in seeking the Lord and what he has for us, because God will grant it. Because God is teaching not only the disciples, but he's teaching this, using this as a teachable moment for this woman and his disciples and those that are around to see the kind of faith that is required to get the things that Jesus has in store for us. Then came she and worshiped him, saying, Lord, help me. After Jesus tells his mission, she comes and cries out and worships him. Jesus tells of his worthiness and the worthiness of the children of Israel, but then also paints this picture of the Canaanite people, those who are not of the household of faith, as dogs. And it appears that Jesus is marginalizing this woman even more. Look what it says. It says, but he answered and said, it is not meet to take the children's bread and to cast it to dogs. The Canaanites were considered the dogs of society. They weren't worthy enough because they were constantly coming up against God's people. And so Jesus is painting a picture and teaching a lesson here. And sometimes in life, people will give us some hard facts about ourselves, about our situation. And we need to stop trying to paint a good picture of somebody all the time. Yes, you may have been on drugs. Yes, you may have been in the street as a prostitute. Yes, you may have been a woman beater. Yes, you may have been. And it's amazing that in society, that when people have gone to jail, been incarcerated and come out and something happens again, we always pull up their past record. And that's what Satan does. But Jesus is doing something even greater than that right here in this lesson. And it says, and she said, truth, Lord, yet the dogs eat of the crumbs which fall from their master's table. And that's good news, because here she recognizes again that Jesus, you are the king. And yes, we have been those people that have been acting like the dogs. But I'm coming to you, dear Lord, and declaring that even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall off the master's table. I'm not asking you to fix me a four-course meal and have everything set on the table for me. Just give me the crumbs that fall from the table that no one wants, that which is going to be cast away. That's just enough for me. If it comes from the master's table, then it's good enough for me in my life. This woman is trying to get out of the margins of life. She confirms the picture that Jesus painted before there of the worthiness of the children of Israel, and how Jesus need to have compassion just as a master would have compassion over the dogs that are in the household that are just eating the crumbs off the table. And Jesus gives this woman the compassion that she deserves. And it says in verse 27, after she said, truth, Lord, yet the dogs eat of the crumbs which fall from the master's table. Then listen what Jesus says. Then Jesus answered and said unto her, O woman, great is thy faith. Be it unto thee even as thou wilt. And guess what? When Jesus declared that whatever you ask for, let it be, then it shall be. Because it goes on to say, and her daughter was made whole from that very hour. And I don't know what it is in life that you've been marginalized and have been pushed to the side of about. What are the areas and the issues in your life that you've been dealing with? But God will give you just what you stand in need of. If you are persistent and you come after the Lord in faith, believing that he is able to do exceedingly abundantly above whatever you can imagine. And when society tells you, no, you can't have it because of this, you continue to ask God. And you read the story of Hannah, that when she was marginalized and pushed to the side by the other wife, and always laughing at her, and everybody in the community laughing at her, pointing fingers at her because she couldn't bear a child, she continued to pray to the Lord and bore her soul out. And God granted her just what she wanted because she believed and had faith enough to believe that God would do it. Don't try to do it your way. Don't try to do it the way society tells you to do it. But God will give you just what you need if you wait on the Lord and don't allow yourself to be painted into the margins. No matter what people say about you, no matter where you live, no matter what side of town you live on, no matter what your heritage is, no matter where you're from, don't allow anyone to put you in that feeling, in that position of feeling that you should be marginalized. You continue to strive for the things that God has for you, because he said that he will make us the head and not the tail. You don't have to live a marginalized life. So I need you to stay out of the margins and trust God. Refuse to live your life in the margins. Don't allow what society has to say about you to keep you there. She knew the Lord was a very present help, and she called upon him to solve the situation that she needed. And Jesus granted her because of her faith, because she was persistent, and she knew that even as a person who has a background, her background of her people, not necessarily that she was, but the people who were painted as dogs and people that weren't worthy, but they at least could receive crumbs from whose table? Society's table? No, but from the master's table. And that's the point, that she still recognized that Jesus was the master and he was the provider of all things for all things that were living, everyone. And she trusted that the Lord would do that. So in the midst of you being marginalized or society trying to marginalize you, this woman didn't want to address the disciples. She didn't face the people who were trying to say, get out of here and run her away. No, but she continued to focus on Jesus. Don't you worry about what the society has to say to you. Don't worry about what the government says about you and how unworthy you are. You continue to press towards the mark and press towards Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and he will move you from the margins of society and put you at the head of his table. God bless you and God keep you. And if there's anyone out there today that has been living life in the margins, your life has seemed to have been marginalized, we want you to think about this message and what God is saying to you and how God is in trying to encourage you to continue to be faithful and trust him for all things that he has in store for us. And when we trust God for those things that he has for us, I guarantee you, you'll be able to move out of the margins of life and sit at the master's table and eat and sup with him. And if you're out there today, you don't know the Lord and the pardon of your sins, you want to give your life to the Lord, this is the time for you to come and give your life to the Lord. Don't worry about trying to get your life together and trying to clean yourself up, but just understand that Jesus Christ will give you just what you need if you trust him. Sometimes we have to just stop and say, yes, Lord, I surrender all and give everything that we have to what God is asking us for. So don't think that you have to do something to get yourself right first. You trust God and you trust him to do what he said he would do, that he'll forgive us of our sins and cast them as far away as the east is from the west. So we extend this offer to you today, that you can put your name in the chat. Just say yes to Jesus and he will guide you into all things. And if you don't want to put your name in the chat, then you can email us at pastor newbeginningshow@gmail.com, and we'll get in touch with you. If you don't want to do it there, you can also send us a text message at 615-473-5464 and let us know that you're wanting to give your life to the Lord. If you want to be a part of this ministry also, if you've already given your life to the Lord and you're looking for a church home, we'd love to have you to be a part of this online ministry. There are many things that we're trying to accomplish, even in the midst of this pandemic. Ministries that we want to minister to the needs of families, couples, and our children and youth. So, if you are that person that has maybe have already given your life to the Lord, but you've been gone astray, then we ask you to say, yes, Lord, I'm ready to surrender myself to you. I call you Lord, Son of David, and I give my life to you. And we will help you and help you strengthen yourself. And if you don't want to be a part of this ministry, please let us know. We'll still help you find a place that you can call home. Just say yes to Lord. Yes to our Lord and Savior. And he will grant you just what you need. Let him know that my life is yours, Lord. I'm tired of living in the margin. And so, please, deliver me from this. Because I know that you can grant me just what I need. You do not own the rights to this music, but this is a song by Brian Courtney Cox. I'll Say Yes. God bless you and God keep you, is our prayer. If you would like to give to this ministry, you can give through givelify.com and send your offering. Just when you go there, you don't have to download the app if you don't want to, but you can just give to this ministry through givelify.com and click on donate and look for New Beginnings HOW at the location 3919 Kings Lane. And you could give through that. Or you can just mail it to us at our address, which is posted on this message, 3919 Kings Lane, Nashville, Tennessee, 37218. God bless you and God keep you is our prayer. And consider yourself dismissed from this service. We love you, and we pray God's blessings on you and your family. Amen.